The Episcopal Church is a church that has traditionally prided itself on freedom of thought. As the late Robin Williams said, no matter what you believe, there's always at least one other Episcopalian who agrees with you. We can differ about Christology and tradition and biblical authority, occasionally the place of Henry VIII, and any number of other questions about the church. But in spite of that, we are basically a peaceful lot. We express our opinions, we listen to others, on rare occasions, we change our mind, and then we adjourn to the bar. It's a nice place to work. However, there is one area that I have found over past decades that will raise passions among many and spirited discussions, not arguments, we are Episcopalians. The tenor of this discussion has sometimes been sharp and has continued over the past 40 years that I've been a part of this church. And this discussion centers around the office of deacon, and more specifically, those who are priest in waiting, transitional deacons. They hold the office for a year, sometimes only 6 months, and then they pass on to become a presbyter, like Tony. 50 years ago, before World War II, the Episcopal Church looked on deacons much as the Roman Catholic Church did during those days. A deacon was the last order you passed through before finally you were a priest. A deacon was a priest in waiting, a period when you learned about servanthood, but was often regarded as tantamount to pledging a fraternity. It was your pledge and the last barrier you had to overcome before you got what you really wanted. I'm happy to say that in the Episcopal Church there was one exception. God left us a witness as to what the deacon's order was all about. There were women deacons. They were called deaconesses, who were ordained for life in their order, never thought about becoming priest, and went through the church acting as teachers, missionary servants that were sent out to bring the message of God's love to the world. I knew one of these women. She was a member of a mountain mission that I was first assigned to after my ordination. Deaconess Hutton was still carrying on her ministry in the Blue Ridge Mountain community of Pine Grove, where she had been for almost 50 years. She was trained at the Deaconess School at St. John the Divine in New York City, and then on graduation, she went back to the mountain missions of the Blue Ridge and the Shenandoah Valley. She had spent her life in Pine Grove Hollow, teaching and leading and calling people to task and being the glue in some relationships and probably the glue that held that community together. If anyone I have ever met was a saint, it was her. And she was a servant. In 1975, when I arrived, men would pick her up in her wheelchair, and she was a large woman, and carry her up the steps. This was before we thought much about handicap access. And she was there every Sunday. I once asked her if I should call her deacon now, since the church had affirmed that deaconesses were truly deacons, and she said no, she had been a deaconess for 40 years and she wasn't going to change things now. She was a good person to live next door to. Deacon Fred on the north side of the church, and Deaconess Hutton on the south side, and I could drop by for pointers. I could ask about families and people in Pine Grove. I could ask about her ministry, about her past. I could ask about how to be a servant. And I took some of her wisdom into my deaconship and into my priesthood. Now, in the past decades, thanks be to God, we have taken steps of restoring to deacons to what the New Testament said that they were. They are a unique ministry unto themselves. The diaconate is not simply a chair for priests to pass through. They have a special call to carry out mission in the world. They work in the world just as Deaconess Hutton worked in Pine Grove. And they translate the word of Christ into the work of Christ. They are, in a sense, the stormtroopers of the church. They do not simply pray for the hungry, they feed the hungry. They are the ambassadors of Christ to the world, declaring the word, Jesus Christ, makes a difference, especially to the poor and the hungry, and the dispossessed. And of course they have a function on Sunday, but that's only the tip of the iceberg. Tony, in the next few months, will be reading the gospel, preparing the table, helping to serve the sacrament. And they have a function that's often less noticed. They dismiss the congregation. Tony will do that for the first time tonight. They tell the congregation that it is time to go back into the world and make a difference. You have been fed with the body of Christ, and now go feed the hungry in God's name. You have heard the gospel proclaimed intellectually, now go out and live the gospel and make it come alive. You are the witness, you are the example of sacrifice. It's quite a calling to be a deacon, a calling for life, a calling that's often harder and more difficult than being a priest. We can spend our time safely inside the church for God. But what of men and women like Anthony as they go on from deacon to priesthood? It is the decision of Trinity Church, the Commission on Ministry, the bishop, three of them, the standing committee, and they all agree that this man is called to be a priest. But today we are ordaining him a deacon. And here is the argument that we often spar back and forth about. Why are we making a man a deacon when he is called to be a priest? He's even given a special title, transitional deacon. For some, that translates into not being a real deacon, and for others, it translates into pledging until he gets the big job. Some argue that priests ought not to be made deacons at all, and others say it's a long tradition that we should not callously set aside. Let me say personally that I am grateful that I was made a deacon before I became a priest. And I would urge you, Tony, to drop in your own mind the prefix transitional. Do not think of this diaconal time as something that you are simply passing through. Look upon it as a gift that God has given you. Your time as a deacon is when you should think about how you are going to be a servant. Remember, the deacon is the office of servant ministry, as the lessons talked about this evening. Servant. A servant who is ready to put himself up, servant, one who is ready to put others before himself. A servant, one who searches out new ways to serve not only the church, but also the world that we're called to minister to. A servant is one who honors the way the church has served in the past, but seeks new ways to use those traditions. A servant who learns humility. We are all simply cogs in God's great ministry. And it's easier for a servant to see that he is not important as he thinks he is than it is perhaps for a priest. Bishops, of course, have no difficulty. A servant is often called upon to work for people that he may know more about a subject than they do. But a servant does not work for being recognized. A servant works in thanksgiving to carry out God's plan. A deacon servant is ready to proclaim the gospel by the way he lives, and he sees that that is more important than proclaiming the gospel by the way he preaches. In my years in the ministry, I have known some great priests. Many of those great priests did not serve large congregations, and their names were never put up for bishops. Some of them did. But great cardinal rectors or great priests in small missions all have one thing in common. They know what it is to be a servant. They never forgot what it meant to be a deacon. I've also known priests who were not so good and not so holy. Men and women rather eaten up with ambition. Priests out to gain glory and credit. And they all had one thing in common. They did not know what it meant to be a servant. They had learned nothing from their time in the diaconate. They saw it only as a trial, a pledge, an initiation. And this isn't just about people being ordained. This is about our life as Christians. Servanthood is the key to practicing our faith. In the end, for all of us, it is not about gathering power or position that brings meaning and purpose to life. It is serving that brings meaning. It is being a part of something larger than ourselves. It is reaching out and helping in the name of God. Tony, you've already demonstrated your service in this parish and in the parishes you served at before, in Crecio, in your time at Bright Divinity School, in the Iona program. You already understand that the call to being a deacon and later being a priest is to take hold of the gift of being a servant. And so, Tony, my dear friend, the man I have known here at Trinity and at Bright, my fellow lover of trains, both diesel and locomotive, treasure these months as a servant deacon. Learn from them. What you learn about being a servant will be part of your priesthood that will define it and make it holy. And one final suggestion. When you become a priest, I would suggest that you do what I've done and down deep in my heart say that I am still deacon second class. Understand that deacons know more about ministering to the world than you do. Remember, they are the frontline troops in our army. They are the NCOs that work with lay people in the trenches. And let this ministry of deaconship teach you about service and humility and leadership in the coming year. And after that year is over, when you stand behind the altar celebrating and blessing and giving absolution, always remember your brother and sister clergy who are perpetual deacons. Thank God for their work, their ministry, and their example to us all. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.